Hello friends, how are you doing? This is Balaji and in this session we are going to take a look into very popular package called NumPy, which is heavily used in scientific computation. So if you want to get into data science or machine learning, then this is one of the core packages that you will use quite often. There are several other packages that are built on top of this package. This NumPy offers a super fast multidimensional array that takes less memory than the built-in list in Python. So I'll show you that. Now consider we have a list called A which holds value 1, 2, 3. Now this list object doesn't maintain an array of values, but it will maintain an array of pointers where each pointer points to the corresponding element of the list. For example, here we have 1, 2, 3, so it will maintain an array of address where the first address points to the actual location of 1, the second address points to the actual location of 2, and similarly the third address points to the number 3. So why it actually has this kind of complex data structure? Why can't it directly refers to 1, 2, 3? Also, why this object looks so complex? We ask it to store 1, but what is this other information? Because in list, we can store any kind of data. Means we can even have a Boolean value after this 3. We can have any kind of data, right? So it needs to know the type of the data. So only apart from the value of data, it also maintains the type information. This 2 are the type information of this value 1. So each element of the list also holds its type metadata. See, each element holds its type metadata. So only the structure looks complex. Means here the 1 is not a single value, it's an object which has value 1 and it also has some of the type metadata too. So only it uses this complex data structure where each address refers to that complex object in the memory. Now let's analyze how NumPy maintains its data. See, here we have much more simpler structure. See, we have direct reference to all the values that are there in our NumPy array. That is because in NumPy, we can't able to store data of multiple types, but instead we can store data of similar types. So only it doesn't need to care about the type metadata. So it needs to just store the value. It doesn't need to store all the type metadata. It just need to store the value. So only the data structure looks much more simpler than our default Python list. See, this data structure looks much more simpler than this data structure. So it occupies less space than our default list. Because here in list, we want to store the address. That requires some amount of bytes. Also, we want to store the value. That requires some bytes. And also, we want to store the type metadata. So it consumes more space other than the data size. So as a whole, this list consumes more space because it is dynamic in nature. We can store any kind of data here, but in NumPy, we can't store data of multiple types, but we can store data of similar types. So it is much more simpler and it is also fast to access. See, because it is much more simpler in nature, because if we type A of 0 means it needs to go to that first index and then it can fetch the value. But in case of list, if you type A of 0 means first it needs to check what is the address of the first element and then it needs to go to that address, there it needs to fetch the data. So the access time is much more less in case of NumPy compared to normal Python list. And then NumPy is able to divide a task into multiple subtasks and then it can process them parallelly. So due to that parallel processing, NumPy operations are much more faster than our normal Python list operation. And then finally, NumPy offers a lot of functions to do scientific computation and all of them are written in C program. So it is much more faster. So this is why NumPy is much more faster than our traditional list. Okay, now we know what a NumPy is, why it is much more popular than traditional list in Python. Now we will make our hands dirty. We will start using NumPy. So for that, we need to first install NumPy package. So I'll show you how to do that. For that, I'll open my command prompt and then here I'll type python-m pip install NumPy. So here we are using pip module of the Python to install this NumPy package. So I'll press enter. In my case, I already have NumPy installed, so only it says requirement already satisfied. But in your case, if you don't have NumPy means it will install that package. Now I am going to use Jupyter Notebook as my editor for this demonstration. You can use any of your favorite text editor, but for this demonstration, I am going to use Jupyter Notebook. Now in order to launch Jupyter Notebook, first go to the corresponding directory where you want to store your script file. I already navigated to that directory. Now here I'll type python-m Jupyter Notebook. Okay, my Jupyter Notebook got launched. Here I'll create a new Python file. I'll rename it to NumPy Demo. Now as the first step, you need to import the NumPy module. So I'll type import NumPy as np. So here I imported NumPy and then I renamed it to np. Okay, so I'll press enter. Now how to create an array? NumPy offers us several functions to create array. I'll show you a few of them. The first method that I'm going to show you is np.array. This method helps us to create NumPy array from Python list. So as an argument, you need to pass a Python list. So I'll pass Python list to it. I'll press enter. See, we got NumPy array. Now I'll check the type of this np.array. For that, I'll store the output of this np.array into this arr variable and then I'll print the type of arr. I'll press enter. See, it is of type nd array, means n dimensional array. This means NumPy allows us to create array of n dimensions. Okay, so here we created a one dimensional array. Now I'll show you how to use this array method to create an array of more dimension. So here to this array, I'll pass a list of list, which means a two dimensional array. Now I'll check the dimension of this arr. For that, I'll type arr.ndim. Press enter. See, it's of two dimension. So here, if we type arr.ndim, it will return 1. See, it returned 1. But in this case, since it is two dimensional array, it returned 2. We can even have array of more dimensions. I'll show you that. I'll create array of 3 dimension. np.array. To it, we need to pass corresponding list. Okay, I created this array, I'll print it. Now we have 3 dimensions. Now I'll show you few other methods to create arrays with some default values. The first method that I want to show you is np.zeros. So as a name itself suggests, this method helps us to create an array filled with zeros. To it, you need to first pass the size of the array. I'll pass 4 as the size, I'll press enter. See, we have all zeros. But see, it is not of type integer, it is of type float. But suppose if you want to have an array of integer means, for that you need to pass on another argument to it. dtype. I'll set to int. See, now it created this zeros array and its type is integer. Okay, so this is a way to use this zeros method. Using this zeros, we can also create array of more dimension. For example, I want to create two dimension array. I want to have 4 rows and 2 columns. See, it created arrays with 4 rows and 2 columns. Okay, we can even create array of more dimension. I'll even create array of 3 dimension. I'll press enter. See, it created 3 dimensional array. So similar to zeros, there is one another method available called ones, np.ones. So this method will create an array filled with ones. Okay, so this is how this method will work. So here I'll create an array which has 2 rows and 4 columns. Present, see, it created array filled with ones. There is one another method also available called full. To this method also we can pass shape as a tuple. So here I'll pass 5,5 and then as a second argument you need to pass the value that you want to fill this array with. Suppose I want to fill the array with the value of 100. I'll pass 100 as the second argument. I'll press enter. See, it created matrix of 5 rows and 5 columns, and then it filled all the cells with 100. Okay, so this is how this full method will work. Now I'll show you one another method, that is arrange. This method works similar to range function, so I'll show you that. I'll pass 10 here. Can you able to guess the output? I'll execute it. See, it generated values from 0 to 9. So it works like the Python default range function. So like range function, we can also pass some start value to it. Suppose I want the value from 5 to 9, means I need to pass 5 as the first argument. See, we got values from 5 to 9. Okay, we can also pass the step value to it. Like, we can pass step value as 2, means it will return all the odd numbers. Now moving on, I'll show you one another method, that is lean space. And then to this method, you need to pass the start value, stop value, and the number of value that you need to generate. I'll pass 5. This method helps us to create values that are evenly spaced between this interval. How many values to generate? This number of values. We need to pass that as the third argument. Okay. Now I'll press enter. See, we got 5 values evenly spaced from 1 to 10. We can generate any number of values. If we want 50 values that are evenly spaced from 1 to 10, means I need to pass 50 to it. See, now our array looks much more bigger. Okay, so this is how this lean space method will work. Now I'll show you how to create an identity matrix. For that, you need to use np.i. And then to it, you need to pass the n value. Here I'll create a matrix of 4 rows and 4 columns. So I'll pass 4 to it. I'll press enter. See, it created that matrix. See, its diagonal value alone are set to 1. Other values are set to 0. So this is how this I method will work. Now I'll show you how to create an array and populate it with some random numbers. So for that, you need to use np.random. There are more ways to create random number. I'll show you few of them. So dot, I'll use rand. Here you need to pass the shape. But note, here you don't need to pass the shape as tuple, but you can pass the shape directly. Suppose I want to have a matrix of 5 rows and 2 columns, means I can pass 5, 2 directly without enclosing it in a tuple. Okay, I'll press enter. See, now it has 5 rows and 2 columns. So this rand method generates random numbers uniformly distributed from 0 to 1. See, all the values are between 0 to 1. Now I'll show you one another method to generate random number, that is randn. So np.random.randn. To this method also, we can pass the shape. Suppose I want to generate a single dimension array. For that, I need to pass a single value to it. I'll press enter. See, we got our random values. This randn method will generate random numbers from standard normal distribution centered around 0. Suppose if you want to create random integers, means you can use np.random.randint. To this, you need to pass the from value and the to value. So I'll pass 1, 10, means I want to generate a random number between 1 to 9. It won't include the 10, it will generate random number from 1 to 9. Okay. Now as the third parameter, I need to optionally pass the size. If you left the third argument, means it will generate a single random number. But I don't want that, so I'll pass the third value. So I'll pass the size as tuple. Suppose I want to generate matrix that has 3 rows and 3 columns, means I need to pass 3, 3. See, we have random numbers from 1 to 9. It will exclude the last value. It will generate random numbers from low to high minus 1. Okay, this is how this randint will work. Okay, so far we saw few methods to generate random numbers. But all these random numbers are not really a random numbers, but they are pseudo random numbers. Means these random numbers are predictable. I'll prove you that. For that, I'll use one another method, that is seed. So I'll type np.random.seed. I'll set the seed value to 0. Press enter. Now I'll execute this line. I'll press enter. See, we got some random values. I'll again execute it. See, we again got the same value. I'll again execute it. Okay, the random value doesn't change. Now I'll change the seed value to some other value like 1 or maybe 14, some random value. Now I'll execute it. Okay, we got different random number. Now again I will execute it. See, again we got the same numbers. Means what? All our random number generator functions are somehow linked with this seed value. Okay, now I'll give you some information about this seed value. For that I'll open my slide. So all these random numbers generated by the random number generator functions are 100% predictable. They use seed value as its input to generate random numbers. Not only randint function, but any random number generator function will use seed value as its input to generate random numbers. I'll show you that. Here I'll set some seed value for this rand function. I'll execute it. See, we got some value. I'll again execute it. See, again we got the same value. Means what? All the random number generator function uses this seed value as its input to generate random values. Now what will happen if you doesn't set the seed value? How the seed value will be generated? I'll show you that. For the first time you run the random number function without setting seed value, at that time the current system time will be chosen as the seed value. For the subsequent calls for the random number function, it will use the seed value generated by the previous random number function call. So each and every random number function, when it generates some random value, before it returns that value to us, it will update the seed value based on the current random numbers it generates. So that updated seed value will be used by the future random number function call. So this is how the seed value will be set or updated if you haven't set the seed value manually. Okay, now we'll practically see how the seed value will be set. Now I'll set the seed value to 0 and then I'll use randint function to generate 5 random numbers. Okay, we got the random numbers based on the seed value. I'll again execute it. Okay, it doesn't change. Now what I'll do is I'll copy this line, I'll paste it here, I'll execute it. See, we got different value. Now I'll again execute it. Again, we got different value. Okay. Now what I'll do is I'll paste this line to this cell. Okay. Now I'll execute this function once again. Okay. Since we have two lines to print, I'll use print function. So print off this thing, print off. I'll execute it. Okay. We got some random numbers. I'll again execute it. Again, we got the same set of random numbers, but this random value doesn't equals to this random value. I'll show you why. Here as the first step, we are resetting the seed value to 0 and then we call randint function to generate 5 random values. So this function will use the seed value set by us and then it will generate the 5 random numbers. But before it returns that random numbers to us, it will somehow update the seed value based on the current random numbers it generates. So that when we call this randint function for the next time, since we haven't set the seed value manually, it will use the seed value that was set by the previous randint function. Got it? Suppose if we want to again reset the seed value, means we can again set seed to 0 here too. Now we'll get the same value again and again. Because now even though the previous randint function update the seed value to some value, we again reset that value to 0. So only we again got the same set of values. Now I'll show you one final case. For that I'll copy this random function call and I'll paste it twice. I'll execute it. See, now we got the same set of values for the first two random number calls and then for the third and fourth call the seed value was set by its previous function call. For this function the seed value was set by this function and for this function the seed value was set by this function. So this is how this random number function will use the seed value to generate pseudo random numbers. So this seed function helps us to share our notebook with our friends so that our friends can also able to generate the same random numbers that we got. So this is the use case of this seed function. Okay, till now we saw few ways to create NumPy arrays. Now I'll show you few important attributes and methods of this NumPy arrays. So the first attribute that I want to show is D type. So for that I'll first create an array. So arr is equal to, I'll just copy the result of this random array. And then I'll type arr dot d type. It will return the data type of the data that are stored inside this array. See, it is a float. So only it returns float 64. Okay, so it returns data type. Now I'll copy this integer random number function and then I'll paste it here. Now I'll check the data type of the result of this method. See, it's of type int32. The another attribute that I want to show you is ndim, which returns the number of dimensions our array has. Here our array has 2 dimensions, so only it returns 2. The another important attribute that I want to show you is shape. The shape attribute returns the shape of an array. To demonstrate you that, I'll create an array of 5x3. Now I'll print this a error. Okay, we have 5 rows and 3 columns. Okay, now I'll show you what this shape attribute will do. See, it returns the shape of this matrix. It has 5 rows and 3 columns. It returns that thing only, 5 rows, 3 columns. Okay, now I'll show you how to reshape this matrix to some other shape. For that, first I'll create a one dimensional array of size 8. Now consider I want to reshape this array. For example, I want to reshape this array to 2 dimensional array that has 4 rows and 2 columns. So I'll type reshape 4, 2. See, it reshaped our single dimensional array to this 2 dimensional array where it has 4 rows and 2 columns. Okay, this is how this reshape method will work. Suppose if I pass invalid numbers like 3 here, means it will show you an error. See, it throws error because now the size of the matrix is larger than the number of elements we have. Here we have only 8 elements, but the size of the matrix is 4 into 3, 12, so it can't able to fill the entire matrix, so only it throws an error. Now what is the use case of this reshape method? Oftentimes in machine learning, you want to make sure the shape of the data that goes into your machine learning algorithm lines up with the other input data as well. So this reshape method helps us to reshape the data to the desired shape that we want. So this is one of the important methods that you need to make a note of. Now I'll show you how to transpose a matrix. So I'll again use the same example. It is one dimensional array. What I'll do is I'll reshape it to 4 rows and 2 columns. Reshape 4 rows, 2 columns. Okay, now if I want to transpose this matrix, means I need to use dot t. That's it. I'll press enter. See, now we have 2 rows and 4 columns. Means what? Our rows and columns got swapped. Now I'll show you how to get maximum and minimum value from an array. For that, I need to have an array. So I'll use this array. Okay, I'll use max method of this array. And then to it, I'll pass the axis. Okay, so I'll set the axis to 0. See, we got the maximum value for each column we have. Suppose consider I want to have maximum values for each row. At that time, you need to set the axis to 1. Now I'll press enter. See, now the size of the array is 5. We got the maximum values for each and every rows. Suppose if you want to get the indices of the minimum or the maximum value, then you can use argmin or argmax function. Now I want to get the indices of all the minimum values, so I'll use argmin. Oh, there's a typo here. It should be axis. See, now we got the indices of all the minimum values that are there in each and every row. Now similarly, you can also use argmax to get maximum values for each and every rows or columns. See, here we got the indices of all the maximum values that are there in each rows. I think I forgot to show you min method. Min method helps us to get minimum values from each row or each column. See, here since we set the axis to 1, it returns minimum value for each and every row. Suppose if you want to get the minimum value for all the columns, then you need to change the axis to 0. See, we got the minimum values of each and every columns. Now to get the shape of the array, you need to use arr.shape. It returns the size of each and every dimensions of an array in a tuple. Here, since we have 2 dimension array, it returns those size 5, 3, 5 rows and 3 columns. And there is also one another property, that is arr.itemSize. It will return the size of an individual element in an array. Here the size of each and every individual element in an array is 4 bytes, so only it returns 4. Now let's move to the interesting part, that is fetching data from an array. So in order to fetch a data, we need to have an array. So I'll quickly create it. Okay, fetching data from a NumPy array is much similar to fetching data from a normal Python list. So we need to use index notation. So I'll do that. Suppose if I want to fetch this 4, means I need to use its index. What is its index? 3. So I need to use an arr of 3. See, we got 4. So this is how indexing works in a single dimension array. Now I'll create a 2 dimension array. So I'll use np.random. dot randint. I need to have random numbers from 1 to 99. and I need to have a shape of 6 cross 4. Means I need to have 6 rows and 4 columns. I'll also set the seed value so that if you are following along, we both can get the same set of random numbers. So I'll set the seed value to 0. You also set the seed value to 0 so that we both can get the same set of random numbers. So I'll execute it. Oh, it should be np.random.seed. Sorry. I'll again execute it. Oh, that's a typo here. It should be random. I'll again execute it. Okay, now we got a two-dimensional matrix of 6 rows and 3 columns. Now, suppose consider I want to get this 88. So, how can you get it? It is there in the third row. So, I'll type. Okay, before that, I'll just store the value of this result to some variable. So, I'll use arr2d, for example. Okay, I'll also print the result. Okay. Here I need to fetch this 88. For that, I'll type arr. The index of this row is 0, 1, 2. So 2. And then the column index is 0, 1. Okay. Oh, it should be arr2d. Sorry. We got 88. Okay. So the approach that we are using here is the double bracket notation. But we can also use one another way to fetch data from this NumPy array. That is single bracket comma notation. That will be more readable than this approach. I'll show you that. Here we can use single bracket and we can use comma to separate indices. See, again we got 88. Note, this single bracket comma notation is not possible in our traditional Python list, but it is only possible in our NumPy arrays. Now I want to get the part of this array. For example, I want to fetch this 10, 84 and then 88 and 71. For that, what you need to do? You need to type arr2d, then you need to pass some row index and you need to pass some column index. And to the row index, I'll pass 2 colon 4. And for the column, I'll pass 1 colon 3. I'll press enter. See, we got 88, 71, 13, 59. Means what? Like Python list, we can also use slice notation to fetch the range of values from an array. Now, as a practice, I want you to fetch the last two rows of this array completely. So, I recommend you to pause this video and try this challenge. Okay, I hope you finished that challenge. That's too simple, right? Now, I'll do it. So, I'll type arr2d of, as the row index, I'll pass minus 2 colon. Means from the second last row, I need to fetch all the rows. And for the column index, I'll just pass colon. Means I need to fetch all the columns. Now I'll press enter. See, we got our last two rows. NumPy also supports some kind of fancy indexing. What is it fancy indexing? Suppose consider I want to select this row 2 and then I want to select this row 4. How can we select this? This is not possible using this slice notation, right? Because if we want to use slice notation, means all the rows that we want to select should be in a continuous position. But here that's not possible, right? Because the rows that I want to select was not in the continuous position. So this is where the fancy indexing helps us. So I'll show you that. Suppose consider I want to select the second row, fourth row and the last row. For that, I'll use arr2d and then to it, I'll pass all the row indices that I want to select. I want the first row, means here this is the zeroth row and this is the first row. And then I need third row. And then finally, I need the last row. You can pass 5 or you can even pass minus 1. I'll pass 5. That's it. Press enter. Okay, it's showing error. Too many indices for array. Okay. The reason for this error is here we are not trying to access each and every rows, but we are using single bracket comma notation to fetch a single value. That's the thing that we are doing here. It is a two-dimensional matrix and we are passing 3 values to it. So only it throws an index error. Means we are trying to access the index that is not available. Now I'll try to enclose these indices in a tuple and I'll run it. See, again we got the same error because it will also tries to use the single bracket comma notation to fetch a single value. So in order for the fancy indexing to work, we need to wrap these indices within a list. Now I'll run it. See, it works. We got our second row, fourth row and the final row. So in order for the fancy indexing to work, you need to wrap your indices with a list and not with a tuple. If you use a tuple, means it will try to fetch a single value from your array. I'll show you that. I'll use arr2d again and then to it I'll pass tuple. And then I'll remove this last value. I'll use 1,3. I'll press enter. 22. It returns single value. Oh, what is that 22? It is there in the first row, last column. So wrapping our indices within a tuple doesn't have any effect because it works like our normal single bracket comma notation, right? So only it throws an index error when we pass three values to it. Because it is two-dimensional array, we can't able to pass three values to it. For three-dimensional array only, we can pass three values. So this was that actual problem. So the main takeaway here is, if you want to use row indexing, just wrap your indices within a list, okay? The another important thing about this fancy indexing is, you don't need to maintain any order when you pass the indices of rows. You can pass it in any order, still it will work. I'll show you that. So I'll change the index order. See, still it works. Now I'll show you how to do conditional selection. For that, I'll create a new array. Okay, here I generated an array that has values from 1 to 10. Now I want to conditionally select all the elements that are greater than or equal to 5. For that, you can use this simple technique. ARR of ARR greater than or equal to 5. That's it. I'll press enter. See, we got the values from 5 to 10. Means what? Our conditional selection works well. Now I'll show you what this condition results. So I'll copy it and I'll execute it. See, we got an array of Boolean values. So it returns true wherever the comparison was true, and it gives me false wherever the comparison was false. Here, we are just passing this array as the input for this ARR. So it will return the value of all the indices that has true condition. Okay. So this is how this thing will work. Okay. Suppose I need to get all the values that are greater than 10 means I should get empty array. See, we got empty array because we don't have any values that are greater than 10. So only we got an empty array. Okay. This is called conditional selection. Now I'll show you how to do some basic arithmetic operations in NumPy. You can use any of the arithmetic operator like plus, minus, division, multiplication on NumPy arrays too. So for that, first I'll create a NumPy array. So np dot random dot, I'll use randint. I want values from 1, 2, 3, and then I need to generate 5 numbers. Okay. I'll print ARR. Okay, this is the value that we got. Now I'll create another array with the same size. Okay, here also we got an array of same size. See, they both have size of 5. Now if I want to do any arithmetic operation, means I can use ARR. These two variables have same name. I'll rename it to ARR1 and I'll rename it to ARR2. I'll execute it and I'll again execute it. Okay. Now I'll add ARR1 and ARR2. See, we got our result as the new array. Here it will do element by element arithmetic operation. So here it adds 2 with 1, 5 with 3 and so on till the end of the array. So in order for this element by element arithmetic operation to work, we need to have two arrays of same size. Okay. You can do any arithmetic operations over two arrays. For example, I'll do subtraction now. So I'll type ARR1 minus ARR2. I'll press enter. See, we got the result. Now I'll try multiplication. See, we got the result. Similarly, you can do any arithmetic operations like division, floor division, or even modulo over the NumPy arrays of same shape and size. Now I'll show you how to do arithmetic operations on two or more dimensional array. So I'll create two dimensional arrays of same size. Now if I want to do addition, then that's simple. It's like the normal addition. It will do element by element arithmetic. See, here 1 gets added with 1, 2 gets added with 2 and so on till the end of the array. Now I'll create another one array, ARR2 is equal to np.arrange. I'll generate values from 1 to 4, so I'll pass 5 as the last argument and then I'll reshape this array to 2 rows and 2 columns. Okay, it worked. I'll print this array too. Okay, it has 2 rows and 2 columns. Now what I will do is, I'll add this ARR1 which has this data and ARR2. Okay, so I'll do that. ARR1 and ARR2. Execute it. Okay, we got an error. That's because we are trying to add two arrays that has different shape. As I said you earlier, NumPy will do element by element arithmetic operation. So here, since the shape of two arrays differs, it can't able to do element by element arithmetic operation, right? It can't able to map few elements. So only it throws an error. So how to solve this problem? There is one solution available. NumPy offers you one feature called broadcasting, which helps us to do arithmetic operation on arrays of different shape. I'll show you that. See, broadcasting is a technique used by NumPy to do arithmetic operations on array of different shape and size. So what it basically does is, it will stretch the size of the smaller array to match the size of the bigger array. That's the thing that it will do. So once the size of both arrays are equal, we can do element by element arithmetic operations, right? So that's the feature of this broadcasting. It will make the size of smaller array to match the size of bigger array. Okay, but why the broadcasting is not working in our case? That's because in order for the broadcasting to work, our arrays need to follow certain rules. So what are all that rules? I'll show you that. So these are the three main rules of broadcasting. Our input arrays needs to follow these three rules in order for the broadcasting to work. So what are these rules? The first rule is, if the two arrays differs in number of dimension, the shape of one with the fewer dimension is padded with one on its left side. So this is rule one. Rule two, if the shape of the two arrays doesn't match in any dimension, the array with the shape equal to one in that dimension is stretched to match the shape of the other array. That's the rule two. What's the rule 3? If in any dimension the sizes disagree and neither it is equal to 1, then an error will be raised. That's the rule 3. So here I'll show you why the error occurs. Here, what is the shape of our array? This is the shape of the array. Okay. Now since the number of dimensions of our two matrix are equal, we don't need to follow the first rule. Okay. The first rule will apply only if the dimensions of two matrix are different. Now since the number of dimensions of our two arrays are equal, we don't need to follow this first rule. Now we'll start inspecting the shape of two arrays from right to left. Note, we should compare the shape of two arrays from right to left, element by element. Okay, now let's start the inspecting of the shape of two arrays from right to left. So the rightmost value for both these arrays are same. So there is no problem, we can compare the next elements. Okay, here we have 2 and here we have 3. So they are not equal and neither of them are 1. So our rule 3 satisfies. What happens if our rule 3 satisfies? We'll get an error. So only we got error in this case. So the main focus here is, the size of each dimension of our array should flow through these rules and it should not get any error. So that's the main focus here. Now I'll show you one another example, working example. I'll set this array to some new value, arr.array. And then here I'll pass 1,2 as its value. I'll press enter. Okay. Now I'll first print the shape of both the arrays. I'll print the array 1 shape and array 2 shape. Okay. The shape of the first array is 3,2 and the shape of the second array is 2. 2 alone. Okay. So the first array is 2 dimensional and the second array is 1 dimensional. They have different shape, right? Now I'll do arr1 plus arr2. Press enter. See, it works now. Okay, how it worked? We'll inspect it. Okay, here the both arrays are differs in their number of dimensions. So it satisfies rule 1. What rule 1 says? If two arrays differs in their number of dimensions, the array with the fewer dimension should be padded with 1 to its left hand side to match the number of dimensions of our bigger array. So as per this rule, the shape of our second array will be changed to 1,2 because the second array has less number of dimension compared to the first array. So only we add 1 to its left hand side to match the number of dimension of our first array. Okay. Now these two arrays has same number of dimensions. So we can start inspecting their dimensions from right to left. So we'll start analyzing it. Okay. Let's start from the rightmost values. Here the both array has same value for the rightmost element, so our broadcasting rule doesn't throw any error because only if the rule 3 satisfies we'll get an error. Here, since these two values are same, we won't get any error. Okay, now we'll compare the next values 1 and 3. So they both differs, but here rule 2 satisfies because here we have 1. What rule 2 says? If the shape of two arrays does not match in any dimension, then the array with the shape equal to 1 in that dimension will be stretched to match the other shape. So here our two arrays has different shape and our array 2 has 1 in it. So we can stretch the array 2 in that dimension to match the size of the corresponding dimension of array 1. So this one will be stretched to 3 because the corresponding dimension of array 1 has the size of 3. So it will become 3. And then the values of the array 2 will be stretched in that dimension. Here it will be row dimension. So our array 2 will become like this. See, here the values of our array 2 got stretched over the corresponding dimension. Now we don't have any other dimensions to process, so it will add these two arrays. So it is a result of the element by element addition of these two arrays. Now we will see one another example. For that I will create another two arrays of different shape and different size. So these are that arrays. Here the first array has 3 rows and 1 column and the second array has 1 row and 3 columns. Now I will try add these two arrays. Arr 1 plus Arr 2. I will execute it. See, we got the result. Means what? NumPy broadcasting works here also. I will show you how it works. Now let's first analyze the shape of these two arrays. Array 1 has shape of 3, 1 because it has 3 rows and 1 column. And the shape of array 2 is 3. 3 alone. Because it is a single dimensional array. Now let's apply the broadcasting rules over these two shapes. First, these two arrays differ in their number of dimensions. So I need to add 1 to the size of array which has lower number of dimension to match the size of our bigger array. So I'll add 1 to the size of second array. Okay. Now let's start comparing the size of two arrays from right to left. So we'll start from the rightmost value. It is 3 and 1. They differ, but this first array has size of 1 to it. So the rule 2 applies here. So we can stretch the size of this dimension to match the size of the corresponding dimension of array 2. So now the size of array 1 become 3, 3 because the corresponding dimension of array 2 has size of 3. So it will also become 3. It will stretch. So now it will compare the next two values. It is 1 and 3. Here also rule 2 applies. So the size of our array 2 will be stretched to match the size of our array 1. So it will become 3, 3. That's it. We don't have any other element to process. So the broadcasting works here. So as a result of our broadcasting, our array 1 will be stretched horizontally. Because since its column size is 1, it will be stretched to 3 to match the number of columns of our second array. So here the stretching will happen horizontally. And our array 2 will be stretched vertically. It has to stretch to 3 to match the row size of our array 1. So here the stretching happens vertically. Now the addition happens for these two arrays element by element. And we got this result. Now I will show you one final example for this broadcasting. For that I will again create two arrays. Here the first array has 4 rows 2 columns and the second array has 4 rows 3 columns. Now I will add these two arrays. We got error. That's because our broadcasting rule doesn't satisfy. I will show you why. Here this is the shape of these two arrays. They both are two-dimensional arrays, so we don't need to apply rule 1 to it. So we'll start comparing the size of arrays from right to left. So the rightmost values of these two arrays are 2 and 3. They are not equal and none of them are equal to 1. So the rule 3 satisfies. What will happen if rule 3 satisfies? We'll get an error. That's what happened here. So this is how broadcasting works in NumPy. So throughout the section, I said broadcasting helps us to stretch the size of the lower array to match the size of the bigger array. But the stretching won't happen really. NumPy won't waste the memory by duplicating the values. It will work like as if it was stretched. Okay. So the stretching thing that I said was just for our understanding. But the stretching won't really happen. NumPy won't really stretch the data. But it will work as if it was stretched. Okay. So this is the main takeaway. Okay. You can even do arithmetic operations on NumPy array with scalar value. I'll show you that. For that, I'll create a new array. And then I'll add it with 2, for example. See, we got the result. This 2 got added with each and every element of this array. Now, similarly, you can do any arithmetic operations you want with any scalar value. Okay. Now, I want to show you one little thing. For that, I'll create 2 new arrays. Okay, I generated 2 arrays. These 2 arrays have same values. They both have values from 0 to 4. Now what will happen if I divide these two arrays? Can you guess the answer? You may think we'll get a 0 division error because the first value of both the arrays are 0. We can't divide any number by 0. So you may think we'll get 0 division error. But that's not going to happen. I'll show you that. See, we just got warning, not an error, till the division continues. Only for the first value, we got not a number. That's because we can't able to divide any number by 0. For the other elements and all, the division still continues. Okay. So this is one of the important things that you need to make a note of. Because in normal Python, we can't able to divide any number by 0. It will throw you an error. I'll show you that. See, we got an error here. But in case of NumPy, it will just warn you. But it still continues the division. Okay. Now I'll show you how to copy data from one array to another array. So I'll create array 1 with the value np.arrange. Here I'll generate values from 0 to 4 and then I'll set arr2 equal to arr1. Okay. Now I'll print the value of both the arrays, one and arr two. Okay, see, both of this array has same values. Okay, now I'll modify the value of array two. For example, I'll modify its first value to 10. Now I'll check the value of second array. Okay, we got the updated result. Now I'll check the value of the first array. See, it also got modified, because here it will just do shallow copy, it won't do deep copy. Means it will just set the reference of data that array 1 holds to array 2, not the actual data. So now these two arrays points to the same location in the memory. So only if we modify any of them, other one also got affected, because they both points to the same location in the memory. That's the actual problem here. So this is the same behavior that we will even get for our Python list. I'll show you that. For that, I'll create a Python list and then I'll set it to L2. Now I'll modify the second value of L2 and I'll print both the values of L1 and L2. See, here also both the arrays got the updated value. So in order to prevent this problem in Python, you want to use slice notation when you copy the data. So I'll type L1 slice of. I'll slice it completely. So it helps us to do deep copy instead of shallow copy. I'll execute this cell once again. Now our list 2 alone got updated, not our list 1, because now they both point to different locations in memory. So now I'll use this same approach for our NumPy arrays too. I'll slice the array 1 and then I'll set to array 2. And I'll again update the value of array 2. And then I'll print array 2. Okay, it got updated. And I'll also print array 1. But see, now also our array 1 got updated. I'll re-execute it. See, again we got the same problem. That's because in order for the deep copy to work in NumPy arrays, we need to use copy method. So I'll type arr1.copy. It will return a new copy of that array and I'll store that result in array 2. Now I'll re-execute all these cells. See, now the changes made to the array 2 doesn't affect our array 1, because now they both point to different locations in memory. So that's the use of this copy method. So the important takeaway here is, don't use the slice notation for deep copy in NumPy arrays, but use copy method. It will only work. Now I'll try to copy only the part of the array. So here I'll copy the first two values of array 1 to array 2. I'll execute it. Okay, it got copied. Now I'll modify the first value of array 2 and I'll print the value of array 1 and array 2. See, both of them got updated, because the slice notation that we do performs a shallow copy, not a deep copy. So in order to do deep copy, we need to use copy method. So I'll combine this slice notation with copy method. Okay, now I'll re-execute these cells. See, now only the array 2 got updated, not our array 1. Because now they both points to different locations in the memory. So changing one doesn't affect another. Now I'll show you few mathematical functions supported by NumPy. Okay, the first method that I want to show you is square root. So I just want to get square root of this array 1, means I need to type arr1.sqrt. It will be np.sqrt. To it, we need to pass array 1. Okay, it is a universal function that np has. Okay, see, now we got the square root of all the values that are there in this array. Similarly, to calculate exponential of all the elements in an array, you need to use exp method. See, we got the result. Similarly, you can also use sine method to calculate trigonometric sine for all elements of an array. Still, there are a lot of functions available in this NumPy. I attached a link in the video description through which you can check all the available methods that are there in this NumPy package. Now I'll show you one important array method, that is dot. In order to show you that, I'll create a new two-dimensional array. Now I'll multiply this array with itself. Here I used multiplication operator to do multiplication. It will do multiplication element by element. Now I need to do matrix dot product. For that I need to use dot function. So I'll do that. So I'll type arr1.dot and then to it I'll pass the array 2. But here, since we want to do dot product over the same element, I need to pass array 1. But see, we got an error, because in order for the dot matrix to work, the number of column of the first matrix should be equal to the number of rows of the second matrix. But here in our case, they both differ. So here what I'll do is, I'll multiply this matrix to its transpose. That will solve this issue. So I'll use dot t to transpose this matrix. See, we got the answer. This is one of the use case of transpose. If we want to do dot products of the two matrix of same size, then we can use transpose to swap its rows and columns so that we can able to do the dot product. Okay, so this is one of the use case of this transpose. Now I'll show you how to sort an array using NumPy. For that, first I'll create an array and then I'll type np.sort, and then to it I'll pass the array that I want to sort. See, our array got sorted. Now I'll show you how to sort a two-dimensional array. So first I'll create it. Now I'll type np.sort, to it I'll pass my array. See, my array got sorted. The sorting happens horizontally, means in the row wise. Now if I want to sort it vertically, means I need to pass one another argument to this sort function, that is axis. I'll set this axis to 0. See, now the sorting happens vertically, means column wise. So to sort vertically, you need to set axis to 0, and to sort horizontally, you can set axis to 1, or you can optionally leave that axis. The default value of this axis is 1, which helps us to sort horizontally. Okay, now we learned all the core things about NumPy. Now I'll show you one interesting thing, how to convert any image into a NumPy array. Because what an image actually is? Image is nothing but a collection of pixels. What a pixel is? Pixel is a combination of RGB, red, green and blue. So now I'll show you how to convert any image into NumPy array. For that you have to install another one package called matplotlib. So I'll install it. So I'll open my command prompt and then I'll type python -m pip install matplotlib. Press enter. Requirement already satisfied, because in my case I already have this package installed. But in your case, if you don't have this package, means it will install that package. Okay. Now I need to first import imread function from matplotlib.imageModule. Okay. I'll call imread. To it I need to pass the path of the image that I want to parse. I already have few images in the images folder of my current directory. So I'll pass the path of one of these images. It will return the NumPy representation of this image. I'll store it in kitten. So kitten is equal to. Now I can check the data type of this kitten. It is a NumPy array of integers. I'll even check the type of kitten. See, it's of type numpy.nd array. Means what? Now we can use all the functionality that we learned about NumPy on this array, because it's a type of NumPy array. Now I'll print it. See, it contains RGB values of each and every pixels of the image. Now I'll check the dimension of this array. It's a three-dimensional array. I forgot to show you one important property of this NumPy array, that is size. In order to demonstrate you that, I'll create a new array. Now I'll type arr1.size. It will return a count of number of elements this array has. See, this array has total number of 10 elements within it. Now I can even check the size of this kitten. Oh, it's really big. Okay, that's it for today's session. Thank you for being with me still here. I hope this video really helps you to master NumPy. If you like this video, then thumbs up for this video, share it with your friends, and then finally, don't forget to subscribe to my channel to never miss my weekly updates. Okay, so meet you soon in one another video. Till then, thank you and goodbye.